Okay. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. We will take today a lecture, one of the most important lecture in the GIT. It is acute appendicitis. A questions you will face in the last year about acute appendicitis. It's a must. Why? Because acute appendicitis is the commonest cause of acute abdomen in all age. Anyone coming to you with acute abdominal pain, pain in the abdomen of acute onset is acute appendicitis until proved otherwise. This is the terminal ileum, and this is the appendix site, and this is the cecum, as we discussed before. What happened? The GIT containing organism very common known as E. coli. And this is the vascularity of the appendix. The appendix has a blood supply very close to the wall of appendix. This blood vessel is known as appendicular artery. Appendicular artery is an end artery. There is no anastomotic artery. It is only appendicular artery. If it is clogged, the appendix will die. Acute inflammations of this organ, it is known as acute appendicitis. As we discussed before, any lesson, any lecture, in the GIT, DAB, CC, DOB. And we will take it, CC, DOB. The first is definition, etiology, and pathology. Definitions, acute inflammation of the appendix. What are the etiology of acute appendicitis? The first thing is the organism. The commonest organism is different organisms mixed, but the commonest is E. coli. Why? Because the E. coli, Streptococcal faecalis, anaerobe Clostridia are normal commensals in the GIT, and so it is easily can come to the appendix. The route of infection. How can infection this organism reach the appendix? It occurs directly from the lumen. The GIT directly from the lumen. But may occur through the vascularity, bloodborne. It's very rare. Usually from upper respiratory tract infection by adenovirus. Adenovirus enters the blood through respiratory infection and then will pass to the appendix. What are the predisposing factors that causing inflammation of the appendix? The appendicitis is divided into two types. This is the appendix. The first type is to obstruct the appendix is a must for appendicitis, known as obstructive appendicitis. What is the cause of the secretions? And so the infection coming from the lumen causing acute inflammation. So obstructions is very common and is a very common cause. Obstruction of the appendix may occur causes in the lumen, causes in the wall, and the causing from outside compressing the wall. So it may be in the lumen, may be in wall, where maybe the cause of obstruction is outside the appendix compressing the appendix. The lumen, like foreign body, any foreign body, like fecalis, hard stool, and some parasite like ascaris, may enter and obstruct the lumen. Causing in the wall, there may be structure or fibrosis in the wall causing narrowing of the wall. And there may be lymphoid hyperplasia. The appendix has a lymphoid tissue, hyperplasia of the lymphoid causing obstruction. Causing from outside, compressing, the very important is mass. Or some mass here on the wall, or sometimes there may be an fibrous adhesions causing obstruction of appendix from outside. However, the obstructive type represent about 2/3 of cases, or sometimes appendicitis can occur without obstructions. It means non-obstructive appendicitis, and the cause is the motility of the appendix is disturbed. So there is stasis. What is the cause of low motility of the appendix, so secretion will be stasis inside it, is chronic constipation. So it is very important that non-obstructive type is predisposed by no mass in the lumen, no mass in the wall, no obstruction from one side, but just only the peristalsis of the appendix is disturbed. There is no peristalsis and usually occur in chronic constipation. What are the pathology? There are two types. The first is obstructive appendicitis, and the other is non-obstructive appendicitis. When the appendix like this, this is a mucosa, this is mucosa of appendix. Mucosa continuously secrete mucus secretions inside the lumen that bathing here and go to the GIT. What happened if there is obstruction here, obstructive type? The obstructive type, the appendix become distended with mucus. It is a mucus only from the intestine. So it is known as mucosal. What happened if the organism will enter inside the mucosal? It will change it rapidly into pyosal. Empyema mean pus and the appendix. So the first stage is mucosal of appendix, which is acute catarrhal inflammation. And the second stage is acute suppurative appendicitis, in which there is infection of the mucosal that changes it into biosil or empyema of the appendix. The blood vessel is very close to the wall. Infection pus inside the lumen will extend the inflammation to the blood vessel. So the blood vessel will be thrombosed, will be obstructed. So what happened? So the happen will occur that there is a gangrene of the appendix. And the perforations occur. Perforation occur at the site of the obstruction. The obstruction here, so the perforation of the appendix occur at the site of obstruction. And this causing peritonitis. What happened in case of non-obstructed cases? Non-obstructed cases, there is no obstructions. Okay, this is appendix. There is no obstruction. So, the non-obstructed cases, the progress of event into mucosal, the progress of events of the inflammation is slower than obstructed type. And so this gives a time for the omentum, the protective mechanism, to surround this appendix and form appendicular mass. So if perforation occur in non-obstructed type, it will be localized by this protective mechanism. But for mucosal to occur and the biosil to occur, it must be obstructions. However, if mucus in non-obstructed type or pus occur here, it will pass to the intestine. So the patient has no mucosal or pyosil in non-obstructive type. Non-obstructive type. So when the pus or fluid is present inside the lumen, the appendix, it will be settled by the gravity toward the tip. And so if perforation occur in the non-obstructive type, it will be in the tip, not in the site, at the site of the obstruction like obstructive type. So when the site of perforation occur at the site of the foreign body near the base, so it is obstructive type. If perforation occur at the tip, so it is non-obstructive type. Okay, so we have changed it into the pathology. What about the complications? What about the incidence? What about clinical pictures? And about investigations? The complication. The first thing of the complications is appendicular mass. It occurs when the immunity of the body is very excellent. What happened? The non-obstructed appendicitis, the omentum and the lobe of the ileum will surround the appendix, protect the appendix from perforation. If perforation occurs, it will be localized. This is known as appendicular mass. So the appendicular mass is not formed of appendix only. No. Formed of appendix, inflamed, cecum, omentum, and the lobe of terminal ileum. What happened? This, when the inflammation of the appendix resolve, the mass disappear within about 1 month, 3 to 4 a week. Or the perforation of the appendix may occur and form localized abscess. The second thing is the appendix may perforate. If the appendix may perforate, it may cause localized generalized peritonitis if no localization occur, or causing localized peritonitis, which is a localized abscess according to the site. Maybe appendicular abscess if the appendix is pelvic type, causing pelvic abscess. If the appendix is present in the under surface of the diaphragm, in case of malrotation, it will form safrenic abscess. So perforation may occur. Sometimes infection may extend through the appendicular vein, iliocolic vein, superior mesenteric vein, and enter into the portal vein. It causes portal bulimia, and it is very dangerous condition. This portal bulimia, it occurred due to infection and septic thrombosis in the iliocolic vein from appendicular vein. Multiple abscess in the liver. Very dangerous. The first thing is the change into chronic appendicitis, in which the acute attack, it will resolve, and the appendix is chronically inflamed. Chronic mean fibrosis. So the appendix will be short and white. Why short and white? By fibrosis. But sometimes may exhibition may complain of recurrent attack of inflammation. What about the incidence? This is a common cause of acute abdomen. More common in adolescents, in constipating patients, and sedentary workers. What mean on a chair? Workers that work on a chair, he can't move. He don't want to move, and so he has a habitual constipation, which is a predisposing factor for appendicitis. What about the clinical pictures? Clinical pictures for non-complicated appendicitis and complicated appendicitis. Non-complicated appendicitis, we have symptom and we have sign. Symptoms, the first is pain. Typically, the patients with acute appendicitis may be colic pain in case of obstructive type or dull aching pain from distension in case of non-obstructive type. The patient usually complain, this is the site of appendix here in the right iliac fossa, but the patient usually complain of pain around the umbilicus. Why? Because the appendix and the umbilicus are supplied by T10. So pain is referred first to start at the umbilicus and then the pain shift to the right iliac fossa. It is due to peritoneal irritation. It is a diagnostic. This vein shift is diagnostic for acute appendicitis. Nothing, no disease can go this vein shift around the umbilicus or iliac fossa except appendicitis. The patients, the vein usually increased by coughing because it hit the appendix. Movement when you palpate and not improved by antispasmodic. Why? Because it's obstructive type mainly, obstructions. So the peristalsis will be continue even if you give antispasmodic. Second, the patient may complain of nausea and vomiting, but nausea is more than vomiting. Why? Because the appendicitis causing reflex bilateral spasm, so the patient may have a nausea and sometimes vomiting, but be careful. When the patient complains first of pain, then vomiting, is acute appendicitis. But if the patient complains of vomiting, then pain, it is gastroenteritis. Is a medical treatment and other is surgical treatment. Third, the patient has no appetite, anorexia, and is very important, almost always present. No diagnosis of acute appendicitis without the presence of anorexia. The patient don't want to eat. Fourth, constipations. Yes, constipations. Why? Because it is a predisposing factor. But sometimes the patient may have a diarrhea. Why? In case of the appendix is present inside the pelvis or abscess, causing irritation of the rectum. The patient may have tenesmus, which is a sense of incomplete evacuation of stool. He go for stool, and then when he get up from the WC, he has another attack. He has another attempts. He has another desire for defecations. Why? Because the inflamed appendix is related to the rectum. It is here causing irritation. Not the cause of defecation is the stool. No, it is inflammation from the appendix. And then the sign. The sign may be general sign, which is usually fever, tachycardia. Fever is mild, severe fever, and high fever in case of empyema or in case of peritonitis. However, a local sign is very important. This is the abdominal wall. This is terminal ileum. This is the cecum. ascending transverse, descending colon, sigmoid colon. The appendix is present, which is present here, and it is inflamed. When we press on the right ilia fossa, the patient has a localized tenderness in the McBurney point. McBurney points, which is the junctions between the lateral one-third and the medial two-third of a line between the umbilicus and the ascites. This site is the site of the base of the appendix. Base, not the tip of the appendix. When we press, it's pain. So it is the localized tenderness. When I release my hand, the appendix will ascend upward and hit to the posterior surface of the anterior abdominal wall. So it is known as rebound tenderness. So the patient has ferrous is localized tenderness at McBurney spines. Then haga rebound tenderness when releasing the local pressure. When I press by my fingers, release the pressures, the appendix ascend press, causing a pain. When I leave or release my fingers, the appendix will ascend upward and causing hit the anterior abdominal from behind. And so it is known as rebound tenderness. Sometimes, when we press on the left side, the intestine here, press on the left side, not right, left, the intestine will push to the right side, or the gas in the colon will push to the right side, hitting the appendix, inflame the appendix. So it is known as Robsing sign or crossed tenderness. Crossed from other side, it is known as Robsing sign. So we have how many tenderness we have? We have three tenderness: localized tenderness, rebound tenderness, and crossed tenderness. If we have a line between the umbilicus and this is the inguinal ligament, and the two edge of the inguinal ligament, it is known as Sheerin triangle. There is a hyperesthesia in this Sheerin triangle. Why? Because the irritation of the cutaneous nerve by the inflammation from inside. So the first thing is hyperesthesia in Sheerin triangle. 5. When you press on the muscle is guarding and rigid muscle. This means that the inflammation reaching the peritoneum surrounding the appendix is about to perforate. 6. What about a special sign? Special sign, because the appendix has a different position, so we have a different special signs according to the position of the appendix. So the appendix, the common site is retrocecal. What is meant by this? This is the terminal ileum, this is the cecum. Retrocecal means the appendix is behind the cecum. Behind. What is found behind the cecum? This is a muscle, very common muscle. This is known as psoas major muscle. And there is a structure very important with peristalsis here is the ureters. So when the inflamed appendix come behind the cecum, it will contact with the psoas, causing psoas spasm. So the patient has a kinked forward like this. Why? Because when he stretch his trunk, causing spasm in the psoas major muscle. And so if there is flexion against the resistance of the hip joint, this is the action of the psoas major muscle, it will be very painful. And the psoas spasm causing flexion of the hip. The hip is flexion. The patient is leaning forward during walking. Flexion of the hip. Why? Because extension of the trunk is very painful. Okay, the second thing is irritation of the ureter. The patient has ureteric colic and usually misdiagnosed as ureteric stone. What happens if the appendix is present inside the pelvis? Pelvic appendicitis. She will find urinary bladder, she will find the rectum, and she will find a very important muscle inside the pelvis. It is known as obturator internus muscle. So The appendix will be inside the pelvis. So what about the pain in the right iliac fossa? Tenderness absent in the right iliac fossa. However, when we perform BR or BV, we will hit the tip of inflamed appendix. Will be tender inside the pelvis. So irritations of the obturator internus muscle. When we do flexion, internal rotation of the hip resistance will cause pain. Why? Because it will, there may be irritation in the rectum causing tenesmus. What happened if I under the liver? This is the second due to malrotation. So the pain will be in the right iliac fossa? No, it will be in the right hypochondrium. And usually misdiagnosed as acute cholecystitis. We open, we find that it is acute appendicitis. Another differential clinical point is that in acute appendicitis, the pain starts around the umbilicus and shift to the right hypochondrium. However, in cholecystitis, the pain is in the right hypochondrium, may be referred to the back or to the right shoulder or to the epigastrium, not the umbilicus. This is the non-complicated cases. What about the clinical pictures of the complicated cases? What about the complicated cases? First, appendicular mass. Second, abscess, appendicular abscess. Third, peritonitis, perforation, due to perforation. Fourth, portal biemia. 5, chronic appendicitis. The first thing is appendicular mass. What is the clinical picture of appendicular mass? The patient come to you, doctors. I have a pain around the umbilicus, settled in the right iliac fossa, and I took analgesic and antibiotic. So the patient give history of acute appendicitis. And then when you examine, you will feel a mass. Mass formed of soft tissue, formed of appendix, ileum, omentum, and cecum. So this mass is tender mass in the right iliac fossa. Ill-defined edge. Why? Because it's a soft tissue. It is an intestine with overlying muscle guarding. However, when the patient complain of the manifestation of abscess like hectic fever, the pain is throbbing pain, and so the you must be sure that the patient have changed into an abscess. So the difference in between appendicular mass and appendicular abscess is a sign of suppuration. And sometimes the patient complains with appendicular abscess, doctor, I have atenismus or frequency. It means that it may be connected to the rectum or to the urinary bladder. What about the peritonitis? It is the same picture of generalized peritonitis, and we'll take it in generalized peritonitis. Portal biemia means multiple abscess inside the liver. High fever, rigors, jaundice, tender liver, hepatomegaly. They are the manifestations of portal biemia. Patients with acute appendicitis coming with pain in the right hypochondrium, jaundice, fever, rigor, it is a portal biemia. However, the chronic appendicitis. Chronic appendicitis, the patient usually complain of recurrent attack of pain. Doctors, every month I have a pain in the right iliac fossa. I usually have anorexia, dyspepsia, dull aching pains, but the attack improve. It is a chronic appendicitis. This is the complicated cases of acute appendicitis. What are the investigations of acute appendicitis? Acute appendicitis is not a laboratory or radiological diagnosis. Why? It is a clinical diagnosis. The laboratory and the imaging we will discuss below is to detect the complications and differentiate from other causes of pain in the right iliacus. This investigation is not to diagnose acute appendicitis, not specific. So the first thing is total leukocytic count. Increase the total leukocytic count. However, high leukocytic count, it means pus or suppuration. Second, brain X-ray. What is the importance of the brain X-ray in erectile positions? Is ureteric stone exclusions in case of retrocecal type. It's simple ureteric stone. Second, we have a gas under the diaphragm in case of perforated peptic ulcer. However, in case of perforated appendix, there is no gas under the diaphragm. So, you know, can patient with perforated duodenal ulcer simulate acute appendicitis? Yes. You will remember that when perforation in the duodenum causing through the paracolic gutter descend downward and they settle to the right iliac fossa. So patients with perforated duodenal ulcers have been in the right iliac fossa. Why? Because the gastroduodenal content will pass through the paracolic gutter to the right iliac fossa. The presence of pain in the right iliac fossa due to perforated duodenal ulcer is known as Valentino sign. So the X-ray to differentiate peptic ulcer, yes, because peptic ulcer may cause pain in the right iliac fossa. The third is abdominal ultrasonography. Abdominal ultrasonography can detect the appendicular abscess, appendicular mass, the presence of pus in the peritone, which is the peritonitis. Can say that there is another cause like tubo-vein abscess causing a pain right, pain in the right iliac fossa. So the differential diagnosis or the investigation is not to diagnose acute appendicitis, but to complications or other causes of pain in the right iliac fossa. What about the differential diagnosis and other causes of acute abdomen and the mass in the right iliac fossa? Must differentiate between it and appendicular mass. What about the treatment? The treatment of appendicitis is appendectomy. Soon or later, appendectomy is a must. Yes. So, uncomplicated cases with no previous five complications, uncomplicated cases, the treatment is appendectomy, either open or by laparoscope. Why to avoid the complication? But the surgery is urgently done in five group of patients. First, age, and six, any child. Old, pregnant, drug, corticosteroid, analgesic. They are the five positions or the five situations in which the patient must be urgently go to operating theater. The child, because the momentum is short, he can't localize. The elderly patients, because of atherosclerosis of appendicular artery, liable to easy gangrene perforation. Pregnancy, because the omentum is trapped by the pregnant uterus, he can't localize. The patient taking corticosteroid or diabetic patient. Why? Because of decreased immunity, he can't localize the patient. Patient taking analgesic. Why? Because it makes the perforation is, if it is occur, silent perforation. That may cause antiseptic shock and die with no pain. Why? Because of analgesic. What about the complications? How can we treat the complications? This is the five complications. How can we treat it? First, patient with appendicular mass. Appendicular mass means appendix, ileum, cecum, omentum, amalgamated together. Direct interaction to remove the appendix in this situation will injury of these organs, causing hazardous fecal fistula. And so, the treatment of appendicular mass now is conservative treatment. Then surgery, but now, first conservative treatment, Ochsner-Sheherin regimen. The patient will sit in semi-sitting position. It is known as Fowler position. Why? Because if perforation occurs, it will be in the pelvis, not toward the diaphragm. If there are diaphragm, it is highly toxic. NBO, intravenous fluid. Why? Because the patient has vomiting and anorexia or nausea. To rest GIT, antibiotic. Mix it. Akinist, gram positive, gram negative, aerobe, anaerobe. Antispasmodic to relieve the pain. And hot fomentation at the site of the mass. Why? To counter irritant, to relieve the pain. Increase the vascularity to attack the inflammation. And we observe the patient by three parameters. Clinically, laboratory, and radiologically. Clinically, general, fever or pulse and pulse. Local, I will palpate the mass for size, tenderness, guarding or rigidity. What about laboratory? The white BCs will decrease. The ultrasound, it will say that the condition is improving. The size of the mass is decreasing. Mean the thecum, ileum, omentum is getting away from the appendix. If the condition improved, conservative treatment that we discussed continue for about 3 weeks. And then appendectomy will be performed after 3 months. It is known as interval appendectomy, and mean after 3 months. However, if the patient is deteriorated by clinically, laboratory, and radiologically, it will attack directly for surgery. It means that a complication more than mass, like perforation, like portal bulimia, a complication, okay. So I must directly attack this pathology. The second is appendicular abscess. We will go and evacuate the bus, extraperitoneal cavity drainage, and remove bus only. You know, we attack to relieve bus. Relieve bus. The bus is present intraperitoneal, but it's sequestrated. We will go through a window and we'll attack the bus and get the bus outside of the abdominal cavity. So it is known as extraperitoneal cavity because it's shuttled from the peritoneal cavity. And then appendectomy is done 3 months later, interval appendectomy. In case of generalized peritonitis perforation, intravenous fluid, antibiotic, Ryan, this is a resuscitation, then explore. Explore means open the abdomen, remove the perforated appendix, lavage the peritoneum, and we would adrenaline to remove any pus present residual. In case of portal bulimia, oh my God, it's an urgent. The appendix must be urgently removed. Remove the appendix and the ligate the ileocolic artery. It's very important. And antibiotic to cover this infection. Recurrent appendicitis, chronic appendicitis means appendectomy. The last thing in the acute appendicitis is appendectomy. Appendectomy or appendicectomy, it is the same. It means removal of the appendix. The first thing is to reach the abdomen, how, what is the incision? When I reach the abdomen, how I deal with appendicitis? And then what are the complications after removal of the appendix? This is the abdominal cavity. This is the umbilicus. This is the McBurney point. This is the site where the base of the appendix is present. And so, under spinal or general anesthesia, we have an incision over McBurney point. This incision is about 5 centimeters. Okay. The last thing is appendectomy or appendicectomy. It means removal of the inflamed appendix. The first thing is to reach inside the abdominal cavity, then dealing with inflamed appendix, removal of it, and then closure the abdomen. And what are the complications? The first is to reach the appendix how by McBurney incision, which incision as McBurney point. So when we take a line from umbilicus to anterior subiliacus point, and the junction between the lateral 1/3 of and the medial 2/3, this point is McBurney point. When I took an incision, take an incision in it, it's known as McBurney incision, about 5 centimeters, perpendicular to this line, not like this. We divide the skin, superficial fascia, we reach the abdominal muscle, we divide the external oblique, internal oblique muscle, aponeurosis, and transverse abdominal muscle usually occur in a gridiron direction because this muscle has a different direction to each other. So the incision lastly will be a gridiron like a network. After dividing the three muscles, we will reach the peritone. We will catch the peritone and open it by scissors. We inside the abdominal cavity. What happened? Identify the cecum, remove the cecum, and we will take the appendix. If I can't reach the appendix, I can reach it by two ways. About 1 inch below ileocecal junction or valve, or if you remember from the anatomy, the convergence of the three tinea coli of the core. This is the appendix like this. This is the appendix. This is the meso appendix. And this is the arterial supply, which is appendicular artery. We will go directly to the meso appendix, suture here over the artery and the divide. So the first thing is the meso appendix containing the blood vessel is ligated and divided at the base of the appendix. So the appendix will be devascularized. At the base, I will crush here at the base of the appendix. And then by suture here and suture here and divide in between. So the appendix will be like this. This is the appendix removed. Then, to be sure, this stump of the appendix is inverted by Peirce sutures. So the appendix stump of the appendix will be converted to inside the cecum by a suture. So the stump is inverted to the cecum by Peirce string sutures. Then we the cecum delivers the cecum inside the abdomen, put it inside the abdomen again, and we divide the abdominal wall in layers and giving and put a drain to remove any secretions from the operation site. What are the complications that may occur during appendicectomy? The first thing is hemorrhage. The hemorrhage may occur from the stump and the bleeding inside the GIT, or from the meso appendix, the blood vessel inside the ligated, this will bleed inside the peritoneal cavity or inside the lumen of the core. The second may be infection inside the wound or intraperitoneal infection. Third, fecal fistula. The fecal fistula due to when I divide and ligate the appendix, this ligature is bad. So will be loose, stool will enter inside the abdomen. The first is imperfect ligation of the base. The first thing is injury of cecum or the presence of a specific pathology like Crohn disease or TB. It will erode the suture and causing fecal fistula. Fourth, hernia may occur. It is either incisional hernia or if injury of ilioinguinal nerve causing direct inguinal hernia. This is the complications of appendicectomy, and usually we have finished like the acute appendicitis or the most important lecture in the GIT. We will go directly to the second lecture, which is diverticulosis coli. Any question, doctors, in the previous lecture? Hi, doctor, are you there?
Yes. No questions.
Any questions?
No.
Okay, you follow me or you are exhausted? We can complete.
Follow you, doctor.
Okay. We will go directly to diverticulosis collage. Coli mean colon, diverticulum mean out pouching. What happened? The story begins about when the stool is present. This is stool present inside the colon. There is a peristalsis in the wall of the core. What happened? the colon proximal to the stool has a prostalsis, contracts whole contractions of the colon, and the part distal to the stool will be relaxed. Why? To push the stool to the distal colon. It's a coordinated movement. It's usual. What happens if there is muscle in coordination? What happens? The first thing is the muscles of the colon will contract in an irregular pattern in coordinated muscle contraction in the form of sphincters, in form of multiple contractions. This is a colon, multiple contraction, not the usual contraction here. This is the mucosa of the colon. This is the mucosa of the colon. This is the mucosa of the colon. What happened? If this contraction is complete, mean close this, and then close this, and then close this. Strong incoordinate muscle contraction. The pressure inside this pouch will be high, increased pressure. What happened? There is an opening in the wall of the colon at the site of entrance of the blood vessel will make the mucosa of the colon bulge through this point, weak point, the site of entrance of blood vessel. This bulge is known as diverticulum. Due to pulsion, increased pressure, so known as pulsion diverticulum, and it is formed of mucosa and submucosa only, mean no muscle in the wall of this diverticulum, only mucosa and submucosa, only mucosa. This is a diverticulum. Stool passing inside this causing stasis. Why? Because there is no contraction, no muscle inside this, so stasis will occur, result in inflammation of the diverticulum, diverticulitis. This inflammation may rupture, so perforation may occur. This is the colon. This is the abdominal cavity, and this is the colon in which the pathology occurs. This is a diverticulum. Perforation occurs, forming abscess here, localized. Or a perforation may occur inside the peritoneal cavity, causing generalized peritonitis. When perforation occurs here localized, it will erode inside the abdominal cavity. So the patient may complain of fecal fistula, has opening in the abdominal wall, discharging stool. Or sometimes the sigmoid colon or the diverticulum may rupture into the urinary bladder or vagina if it is present in its way. This is a general overview of patient with diverticulosis coli. So we will concentrate our head. What are the etiology? The etiology is acquired. It is an acquired bulge and diverticulum. It's acquired bulge and diverticulum due to muscular incoordination. This muscle incoordination causing increased intracolonic pressure, the pressure inside the colon here, causing herniation of the mucosa at the entrance of the blood vessel at this weak point. What is the most important predisposing factor for this incoordinate muscle contraction, this rings, is chronic constipation. This is the etiology of this disease. What about the pathology? The common site is in the sigmoid colon. Why in the sigmoid colon this is the common site of this diverticulum? As if you know, I said to you before that the lumen of the colon get narrower as we get distal. So the sigmoid colon is very narrow in comparison to the rest of the colon. And so the constricting link will become more complete in sigmoid than other colon. So the pressure will be higher. Then, this is the first thing. The second thing. You know, the sigmoid colon has a mesentery, known as sigmoid mesocolon. If we have a cut section, this is the sigmoid mesocolon. Has three tenia, as we have discussed before. This is three tenia. And this is the mesentery, which is sigmoid mesocolon. can you define actually the site of the diverticulum? You know, this is mesenteric border, mesenteric tinea. Why? Because it is related to the mesentery. However, the last two, these two, is anti-mesenteric tinea. Again, the mesentery, away from the mesentery. This tinea, which is anti-mesenteric tinea, like this, which is a muscle, has two border. This border and this border, the beginning and the end. This beginning is known as mesenteric border of anti-mesenteric tinea. This is mesenteric border towards the mesentery of anti-mesenteric tinea. This is anti-mesenteric tinea. This is a mesenteric border. This is anti-mesenteric border. The diverticulum usually occur in this area, the mesenteric border of anti-mesenteric tinea. So, occur in rows along the mesenteric border of the anti-mesenteric tinea. This is the pathology. What about the complications? First, inflammation. Second, perforation. Third, fistula, external or internal fistula. Fourth, intestinal obstructions. And the fifth, bleeding. They are the five complications of the diverticulum. The first is inflammation. It is the commonest complication, is inflammation of the diverticulum. Is it common? Yes. Why? Why? Because there is a stasis. No muscle layer. So the stool will become inviscerated, mean hard, causing obstructions, causing infection and diverticulitis. The second thing is perforation. It may be perforate, either localized abscess or generalized peritonitis. The fistula may extend to the outside, causing external fecal fistula, or may inside the organ, like urinary blood, like the vagina, like intestine, is known as internal fistula, colovesical, colovaginal, or coloenteric fistula. Sometimes the repeated inflammation of the diverticulum causing stricture. This stricture causing internal obstruction. Finally, is the bleeding. The diverticulum here that occur, it is related to the neck of the circular artery. It is a blood supply to the colon. The diverticulum, the neck of the diverticulum, what it bulge, it very close to the long circular artery to the colon. So it will erode the bleed, it will erode the artery, causing extensive, massive bleeding. Diverticulosis coli is the commonest cause of profuse bleeding per rectum. Commonest, profuse in old age. We will take and describe the clinical pictures of each type separately. First, the presence of diverticulum present, but without the five complications. It is known as uncomplicated cases, which is known as diverticulosis collage. Just the presence of diverticulum. This is the colon, and this is the diverticulum inside it. Just the presence of diverticulum. Just only. It is known as diverticulosis coli. Usually, if it is mild, asymptomatic, no symptoms. But sometimes, from the contractions, the patient may have treatment for irritable colon for a long duration. In the form of some pain, distension, tender colon, the presence of the diverticulum will make the colon thick and tender. Can we diagnose these conditions? Yes. If we inject a barium inside the colon, which is the barium enema, the lumen is narrow, and then the barium will enter inside the diverticulum, causing globular shadow, which is the barium filled diverticulum, and we will see the colon itself will be like a saw, sawtooth appearance due to segmental contractions. This is a serration. Can we enter through colonoscope? Yes, I can see the opening of the diverticulum. What is the treatment of this condition is conservative treatment. Why? It's no complicated cases. Stop purgative, high residual diet to regulate the contractions of the colon, like whole bread in the meal or vegetables, antispasmodic, and it will sometimes improve the condition. What about the complicated cases? Complicated cases, it is a diverticular disease. The first thing, what happens if inflammation occurs? Diverticulitis. Inflammation of the diverticulum. What is clinical picture, investigation, and the treatment? The clinical picture, it is similar like appendicitis. The pain will shift but to the left ilia fossa. Why? Because the common site is present inside the sigmoid colon, the diverticulum sigmoid colon, however the appendix in the right ilia fossa. So pain, periambolical, shift to the left ilia fossa, it is diverticulitis. Shift to the right ilia fossa, it is an appendicitis. So sometimes we describe diverticulitis as left-sided appendicitis. Why? It is typical like appendicitis, but the pain will shift to the left ilia fossa. There is fever, tender, rigid, the same like appendicitis, but in the left iliac fossa. Can we perform colonoscope or barium? No. Why? We'll perforate the inflamed appendix. What is the diagnosis? Is CT. The treatment of diverticulitis is the treatment of appendicular mass. Who is the Ochsner-Sheerin? Conservative treatment. Till inflammation subsides in appendicitis after 3 months, interval appendectomy. Here. When the inflammation subsides, the recurrent attack improve. What happened? We will go perforate the colon and we resect the mass containing the diverticulum and anastomose the intestine. It is known as resection and anastomosis, and we will describe it later on. What about the perforation? The clinical picture, perforation peritonitis, either localized peritonitis abscess or generalized peritonitis, fecal peritonitis. High bacterial content, severe toxemia, bino tender, and vomiting, severe manifestation. X-ray will soak gas under the frame. Leukocytic count will be increased. Treatment is urgent to surgery after resuscitation, and we will take the following. When perforation of the diverticulum occur, we may perform the surgery in 3 stages. Two stage or one stage. What is this? This is the colon. Transverse, descending, sigmoid, and the rectum. There is perforation here. The first stage is suture the perforation, explore the abdomen, suture the perforation, and the right transverse colostomy. Get the colon outside by opening. Where the stool coming here, and to outside, not reaching the site of perforation. Till about 1 month, 3 weeks, we will prepare the colon and resect the mass. Primary anastomosis, resect this mass removal and anastomose under cover of this colostom. And the third stage is closure of colostom. So the first stage is just a closure perforation, proximal colostom is the first stage. Second stage is remove the diseased affected segment after chemical mechanical preparation of the colon under cover of this colostomy, and the third step is colostomy closure. Two stage may be the following. This perforation here is to dissect the affected segment like this. Proximal end is opened as colostomy. This is the first stage. So the first stage is resection affected segment, the proximal end as colostomy, terminal colostomy, and distal end is closed. It is known as Hartmann operation. Then after that, 3 weeks, we will go and anastomose the colon to the core. This is the two stage. One stage, no. We will go directly for resection anastomosis. Perforation, no. We will go resect and anastomose the colon to the core. But resection anastomosis of the left side of the colon, high instance of continuous leakage. We have said before. Why? Because of five things. Weak muscle, incomplete serosa, poor vascularity, high bacterial content, continuous gas extension. And so it is a must for us to remove the bacteria and the stool and the gas inside the colon. And it is done by intraoperative mechanical, chemical and mechanical preparation of the colon. We will go directly. We put a catheter here. And we push a saline inside the colon to wash the bacteria outside before anastomosis. And then, till the fluid is clear, no stool, no bacteria, and we will go to anastomose the intestine together, directly. One stage. It is known as Dudley lavage or intraoperative colonic lavage. I must clean the colon from bacteria and stool and gas inside it. So, it is a one-stage operation. What about the intestinal obstruction? The patient has a regular restriction and sigmoidoscope is diagnostic, and the treatment is either a 3-stage, 2-stage, or 1-stage, mean like perforation. What happened if fistula occur? Fistula may occur to the outside, draining to the outside due to varicolic abscess, mean abscess around the colon, but then open to the skin. External fistula. Or internal fistula, colovasical, colovaginal, coloenteric fistula. If it is a colovaginal, offensive vaginal discharge, stool from the vagina. Colovasical, it means dysuria, pneumaturia, and even fecaluria. Diagnose how? By injecting a dye in the colon, appear in the vagina, or appear in the intestines, full intestine, or appear in the urinary bladder. If we have cystoscope, we can detect the opening in the bladder. Cystography. The dye will appear in the colon. So it's a fistula. The treatment is, this is the colon. Assume this is the urinary bladder. And there is a fistula in between. What happened? I will resect this. Resect the fistula. It is an fistulectomy. Closure the defect inside the organ, the urinary bladder. And this part is resected and anastomosed. But must after chemical and mechanical preparation of the core. This is a fistula. What about the hemorrhage or bleeding? The bleeding is characteristically profuse bleeding, rectum, massive. How can I diagnose? Can we diagnose by colonoscope entrance as the colon? No. Very difficult. Why? Because horrible bleeding coming to you in the camera of the endoscope, you can't see either brain enema. But the most important investigation is angiography, selective angiography. We will go to the inferior epigastric artery and we'll go and inject the dye, like celiac angiography in bleeding peptic ulcer. However, here left side, if the bleeding diverticulum in the left side, inferior mesenteric angiography. And bleeding in the right side, diverticulum, so it's superior mesenteric angiography. So the angiography is very important, either diagnostic or therapeutic. As we discussed before, here is the same. After resuscitation with blood transfusion in case of bleeding, embolization by gel foam embolization. What happens if numerous and numerous diverticulum is present inside the colon and all of them bleed? What? Massive bleeding. What happens? I will remove the whole colon. It is known as total colectomy. And then this ileum is anastomosed to the rectum, ileorectal anastomosis. Then this is in case of massive bleeding. I will save the patient, remove the whole colon with the bleeding diverticulum. Thank you, doctor. So we have finished the lecture today. I hope you can understand, and I hope you affection you want. I am ready to hear.
Doctor.
Yes.
On appendectomy. If
yes.
The appendix is inside the pelvic or retrocecal, will
yes.
The operation be the same?
Yes, the same. It is mobile. I will get to the base, push the base, the tip. Whoever it is present in the pelvis, retrocecal, preilial, will come out because it's mobile. It is the same. Sometimes difficult, but it is the same. Surgery.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Any question, other doctors? Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Doctor.
Thank you, Doctor.